in ECE, and Todd is an alumni of ECE. So you know we're very neutral about departments. We love all of the engineers, and they end up coming back to be computer interested and computer related anyway. So we are glad they are here. You probably seen the announcement. We have their bios and everything. They're impressive.
I'm afraid this will be also videotaped and put online somewhere so you can capture it for posterity.
Yes, and you can review it when you are have a free moment to refresh your memory. Okay.
Before we get going, I'd like to put in a plug for the IEEE. How many of you are IEEE student members or just members? Chris, aren't you a member? Okay. So Dr. El Magrabi is a life member. That's not the same as a life sentence, but he has been very active in IEEE over the last 30 or 40 years. And if you're not a member, you should be, because this is how you find out about things like control engineering. The thing to understand is there are 37 societies in the IEEE. One of them is the Industrial Automation Society, and that is the area in which we operate as a company, Control Touch Systems. I might also mention Chris Foreman. Dr. Foreman is a former alum, or I guess you're still an alum of this program, and he has actually worked in the controls industry and done PLC programming, and at one point in time taught a course on PLC programming here at University of Louisville. And one of the things we're discussing with Dr. El Magrabi is how can we rejuvenate that course and bring it back to life. And we, in the last 2 years, or possibly 3 years, have hired over 50 co-ops in our program. And we use these co-ops as control engineers. And I apologize if this projector keeps wanting to go on vacation, but it'll come back in a minute. So so this company was founded by two University of Louisville alums of ECE. And then in addition, there's a third participant. Is there any way we can get this thing to quit going to sleep?
It's the first time that happened.
Okay. I don't know whether it's the computer or the projector or what, but in any event, I'm not sure what's going on. Get the back girl. So anyway, we'll just do the best we can with the projector. The thing to understand is that this company's been in business now for over 25 years. It was founded by University of Louisville alums, and one of the things they do when they interview you is ask you which basketball team is your favorite basketball team, and it should be the Cardinals. Don't come in and be a University of Kentucky fan. That would not be good. We are growing. Currently, we're on Breckenridge Lane near Heights Point, and right now we've hit 50 engineers and other employees, and we have recently been acquired by another company here in town called Silicron. And the reason we merged, the two companies merged, is so that they could go after bigger jobs. And I'll talk about that in a minute. How many of you have ever taken a project management course? Okay, have you ever practiced project management out in your, any of you worked in industry as project managers? Little bit. Okay. Well, this is a project-driven company. Every single employee is working on a project. We don't have the luxury of people sitting back and thinking about the next development. So projects have a birth and a death, and most of our projects run anywhere from a year to 2 years. What we try to do is assign engineers to the projects, and Todd, for example, has been with the company, what, 13 years?
Yeah, a little over 13 years.
So he came in as a baby engineer, and now he's an engineering manager. And he can tell you what a thrill that is, having a bunch of engineers working for him. What we do is we build control systems. And control is a very general field. But the thing to understand is that all of these systems, you have actuators, you have motors, you have sensors, you have detectors, you have software that has to make decisions and do things, and you're trying to accomplish a goal. These can be anything from an automotive assembly line to a baggage handling system for an airport. We've got a number of companies here in town that make use of these systems. We also have to support what we design and build and implement. So the motivation behind this lecture is that students do not get exposed to this aspect of the industry in an academic environment in general, unless they happen to be a co-op at a company that does this kind of work. All control systems are one of a kind, and what makes these control systems one of a kind is the fact that the architects never build the same building twice in a row. So the thing about it is that if you have to use conveyors to transport either merchandise or baggage or any product around, get it from one place to the other, then the conveyors are going to have different layouts. We'll go through a typical layout. So all of these are custom. Every single system we work on is custom. And that's what causes Todd to lose hair. That's why I lost all my hair. He has to somehow design a control system that will make this thing work. So we get a requirements document from the customer, and then we have to do everything else to make these things work. Now, we do not do the conveyors, but we do all of the system that controls the conveyors. We have to produce a lot of documentation. How many of you like to write? That's about the right number I would expect, zero. Engineers don't like to write. Somebody has to write. So we have engineering drawings, and Todd has brought a set of drawings if any of you are interested in looking at them. We have to create maintenance manuals, operations manuals. We have to create test plans. These, by the way, most of our customers are government or municipality or something in between. And so that means that that's how you get the $2,500 toilet seats you've heard about. You have to fully document it. We have to have test plans. These systems get tested either by the owner or, in the case of baggage handling systems, by the TSA. Does everybody know what the TSA is? Okay. And then after you've done the testing, you have to write a report. So all of you have been in labs. This is like a lab report on steroids. It's 200 or 300 pages long with all the results and pictures and everything else. So about 70% of our business is in baggage handling, which is a particular type of merchandise if you think about it. Most of our jobs are in the United States. We've got a bunch of jobs going on with airports. We do a lot of wastewater management. Wastewater management is what happens when you flush the toilet. If you've ever thought about where that goes, that's what wastewater management is about. Industrial projects, assembly lines for automotive companies and things of that nature, and distribution centers. The span of our geography is anywhere from Prudhoe Bay to Fort Myers, Florida, or I'm doing one up in Richmond, Virginia right now. We've got jobs going on in New York State. We have jobs going on in Southern California and so forth. And the biggest job we've got, which I'm involved with, is Las Vegas, Nevada. We're recontrolling the entire Terminal 1 airport. That's an airport that has 48 million passengers a year going through it. So if you think of that, that's a lot of bags that have to get from the ticket counter to the plane and back off the plane to you on a carousel. I've actually got some pictures of the Los Angeles airport. So the motivation then is to help you understand, as engineering students, how your discipline, which is electrical engineering or computer science, might fit into this industry. And as I mentioned, I'm gonna try to play this 2-minute video and we'll see if it works this time. that works with no sound, but that's okay. Sound is not something I do very often.
So this is a young lady putting her bag on a ticket counter. It goes through the wall, and then this is what happens behind that wall. And you go through a myriad of other conveyors, and then eventually, if I can get it back, that's the explosive detection machine. It's being x-rayed, it comes out, it gets picked up. In this case, it's shown being scanned, the bag tag's being scanned by hand, and it's then put on a tug, which is taken out to an airplane, and then the bag handlers put these put baggage onto the airplane, and then it comes out at the destination onto a carousel, hopefully, without being damaged. So that's a commercial that Delta put together called No Bag Left Behind. So that's pretty simple, isn't it? Now, when you consider that the Terminal 1 of the Los Angeles Airport, or Las Vegas Airport, pardon me, Los Angeles is even bigger, has five different baggage handling systems in it. Each one has 600 to 700 conveyors that have to be managed. And you've got ticket counters that literally are two blocks long where you can check your bag. Now that's divided up by airlines. So what I'd like to do is go through a little bit of history. You've seen how the bag travels through the system. We divide our systems into inbound and outbound. Outbound means it's getting from the ticket counter to the plane. Inbound means it's getting from the plane to the carousel. We're going to go through the outbound system, an example, so you can get a feel for it. And we don't have time to cover an inbound. Just consider the inbound systems to be a very simple case of a conveyor system. So we have a few organizations, but primarily the ones that we work for are the Transportation Safety Administration and the International Air Transportation Association. Now you might think about this. If I check a bag in Los Angeles and come to life and I'm flying to London, England, that bag will come out on a carousel. So that tag has to be a standard format in order for all the airlines in the world to be able to read and interpret it. And what's encoded in the barcode on the tag is the information that tells what flights or sequence of flights have to be used. And sometimes you might get a bag re-tagged in the middle of the trip. Everybody remembers 911. As a result of that, all baggage on a plane has to be screened. There are a half dozen different methods to screen a bag, and if the most intrusive is a hand search, but that's also that takes the most time. So when you're handling 48 million passengers a year, you have to do things automatically. In the United States, all of this is done automatically up to a point. So when you saw that bag in the video go through the explosive detection system, that is an x-ray machine similar to an MRI in terms of its size and construction. And what it does, it takes an image of the bag and then using other algorithms, it makes determinations as to whether a bag is suspect or whether it's clear. If the all the images of all bags get looked at by an on-screen reading room. So the operator has about 45 seconds to make a decision. And once that decision is made, it's either clear and goes onto the plane or it's suspect and goes to another area called the check bag resolution area or the CBRA. This is an automatic explosion detection machine. And essentially, it's about the size, I'd say they're 30 feet long, something on that order, 8 or 9 feet tall, about the same width. And you can basically, with one machine, you can inspect about 10 bags per minute. So from a design point of view, give some thought to, if I've got 48 million passengers a year, how do I design a system that can handle that volume of traffic? Because these systems have to do that. Otherwise, bags don't get on planes and people get very upset. There is a requirements document that we have to design our systems to called the PGDS, the Planning Guidelines and Design Standards for CBIS, or Checked Bag Inspection System. There's a whole family of consulting companies. Raytheon is one of them. Battelle is another that verifies that our systems meet these requirements. And the thing I'd like to emphasize is it takes a lot of conveyors to route bags around this system. So here's a very typical system here. This is actually one of my projects. Todd's guys did the design. It's a relatively small system. This is the Wichita Airport. These are your two ticket counters, and they merge together at this point. They come down, this is called the main line, and there is a tag reader right here. It reads every single bag. Then they get routed into one of these three explosive detection machines. They come out, they come into a vertical sorter, and they either go to a clear line or to a suspect line. If it's a clear line, they end up over here, and the tag gets read again, and it sends the bag to one of these two carousels here. And then the bag handlers pick the bags up, put them in the tugs, and take them to the plane. If it's not clear, then it comes into this area here, which is called the Zebra, and they actually hand inspect each bag, and then they make a decision if it's available, if it's clear, if it's, for example, there are certain things you can put on. We've talked to the people in the airlines, and you wouldn't believe the stuff that people put on in their bag. You know, sausage, everything you can imagine. And then they put it back onto this conveyor, and it goes out into the carousels area. So I have 3DS machines. How many bags can I get through this airport in 1 hour? You've had all the information you need to answer that question. So you can do 10 bags a minute. That's 6 seconds a bag. I got three machines, right? Well, actually, you want to just be using two machines that have one in standby. It's a redundant machine. So the answer then is 600 bags per hour per machine times two, 1,200 bags an hour. So we talk about this in terms of the subsystems. Now, those of you, has anybody in here had a system engineering course? Thank you. Appreciate it. There is a very nice system engineering course in industrial engineering. You should try to take it before you leave here. It's not taught in school in general. But these are the different elements of the outbound and the inbound system. So you have ticket counters. That's where the public area is. And then they go through the wall, through a secure door that opens only when bags need to go through. And then they get put eventually onto the airplane. That's referred to as the airside. On the inbound leg of the trip, then they take the bags off the plane, put them on load belts, and then they just transport them to the carousels. We have other support areas, server rooms, about the size of the server room you have upstairs in this building, and control rooms. Has anybody worked in a network operations center? No network engineers here? Well, it's the same concept. It's gonna sit there and watch TV. And an alarm goes off, you go, oops, we've got a jam on conveyor number such and such. So I've pretty much gone through all this. The key here is that there's a variety of ways to read these tags. The most common is a laser scanner. And by doing that, you can not only read the tag, but you can measure the size of the bag. Because there are limits in terms of the length that you can transport on the conveyor system and the width and the height. So, you know, ticket agents and bag handlers are they're not the most energetic people in the world. So if you got a golf bag that's 2 inches over the maximum length, they may put it on the conveyors anyway. So what has to happen is when it hits that measurement system, it stops the entire main line. They've got to fix it. This is the typical bar code on a baggage tag. Now the thing to understand is that these tags have to be read on the fly by the reader. They can be folded up under the bag, they can get torn, they can get mangled, they can be printed poorly. There's quite a bit to just printing the tags. In Las Vegas, they use RFID tags, but only in Las Vegas, so you have to have the regular tag on there. Once the bag tag is read, you cannot lose track of the bag. That's just the way it works. So I want you to think about having 1,200 bags an hour coming down this one conveyor. You cannot lose track of one. How would you do that? Something very simple, something called software. But there's more to it than that. The other thing that can happen, bags can get cocked. So depending on how you're measuring the bag, they can grow. They can get jammed and pushed together. You have to keep them separated. So, I'm sorry, I'm coughing. So anyway, if the bag is clear, it goes to makeup area. I've already talked about this. So here's the different subsystems for this small airport. This airport has about 14 gates. It's probably the size of one arm of the Louisville airport if you've been out there. And so you've got the ticket counter area, you've got the check bag inspection area, and you've got the makeup area. This does not show the inbound system. So these conveyors do different things. One thing they do is they move things from one place to the other. The other is you've got to pull gaps between the bags and also detect the presence of a bag. So if you obscure that photo eye too long, that's interpreted as a jam, and you have to stop all the bags from coming down or you'll have a train wreck. Most of the conveyors are 5 to 20 feet long. They can be curved, straight lines, inclines, declines, sorters, and carousels. Here is a merge. So the bags come down the conveyor on the left or in the back, and they merge onto this main line. This is usually, these types of locations are usually where you have a jam, because you can imagine, you've all driven, I'm sure, so you can imagine what it's like to merge onto the Watterson Expressway during rush hour. Nobody wants to let you in. You have to sense where the bags are and create gaps to let the bags come in. There's also, you have to start and stop the conveyors. How many people have played with a VFD? Chris, you can't raise your hand. Well, VFD stands for variable frequency drive. And what this does is this is a device that controls the motor. Thank you. I don't know if I can do this without sounding like I've got a mint in my mouth, but I'll try. Very good. So I can speed up and slow down the motor. Then I've got a photo eye to detect that the motor is there. Or detect how fast I'm going and that a bag is there. And then you have to also have an encoder to detect the number of RPMs per minute that your shaft is turning. Those are the inputs to your software system. Now here again, in Las Vegas, we have a rate in each of these terminals of about 3,000 bags an hour. So there's a lot of calculations that have to be going on in order to keep track of this thing. So you've got horizontal and vertical diverters. And this is just how you, well, wait a minute here. Got the merge, and then we've got diverters. This is a horizontal diverter. So what happens is that paddle swings out and will shuttle the bag off into one of the lanes for the EDS machine. And I believe this is the Wichita Airport. So there's three lanes shown here. This might actually be in Las Vegas, I can't remember. So here's the location of all those diverters. And I forgot to mention, there are two vertical sorters. There's a vertical sorter on the output of each EDS machine to take the bags up onto the clear line of the suspect line. And then the makeup area is pretty much the same as what you have seen when you pick your bags up off the plane. Let it be said that if you can't read the IATA tag, we have to assign a pseudo identification number because we still have to track that bag even if we can't read the tag on it. So we refer to how the bags are placed on the belt as bag hygiene. And have you ever thought about bags with rollers? What happens if you put the rollers down? You can basically end up with a jam because the rollers will sit there and roll along on the belt until the next bag comes along and crashes into it. We also have industrial control panels, which Todd and his people designed to run all this equipment. And then we have machines that you're familiar with, clients and servers and networks, to sort and route bags. And then we have other displays, operator displays. So here is, this is actually, you can't see this very well. This is actually the MCP. It's four doors, so this thing's almost 16 feet. How wide are those doors? 6 feet? 4 feet?
4 feet.
Okay, so it's four times, 16 feet long. This is called a panel view. It's basically a touchscreen PC that has a replica of the conveyors that are controlled by that particular system. This is the interior of that MCP. And every single wire in that MCP was checked and labeled and laid out by Todd's people. There's thousands of them. Here's an inline EDS machine, and if I were standing next to it, I'd come up to about the top of the opening going into the machine. Okay, so so human beings have to operate this system. The thing to think about is, well, how do they do that? So you've got to know if a jam occurs, you got to know where it is, and you've got to display that to an operator so they can go out and find a particular place. These Seabus areas in Las Vegas might be a city block long. So now you've got 600 conveyors out there and you've got a jam, and you need to know where it is. Here is, these are panel views built by Allen Bradley, but as I say, they're basically industrial strength PCs that run Windows CE on it. And we have a whole software development environment to develop the human machine interface that we use on these machines. Josh Fritzler's people do this. In addition, we have what's running behind the scenes is a programmable logic computer, and we also have to generate the program for those PLCs. On the human machine interface, it helps you understand a little bit how the system works. If you take a look at these, you've got the layout and the topology of the conveyors, and you've got the alarm screen banners, a history of alarms. So for example, if you're always getting jams at one particular place, you've got to figure out why and then fix it. And then you have to have a legend. Now this is an airport. And this is the Philadelphia Airport. This is an inbound system, and this is actually Terminal F, if any of you have ever flown up there. But the thing to understand, this conveyor system is almost 800 feet long. It goes across the street in between two buildings. This is the legend screen. It talks about all the different colors of the icons that are representing the different conveyors. This is how you can operate the machine or the system manually from the panel view. This is an alarm screen. You can see there's an emergency stop and a jam fault that has happened. And then this is the history screen. So let me go back here and see if this will work. This is the startup sequence of that same conveyor system I just showed you. So if you're standing anywhere near it, you get this very loud horn, which literally will make you grind your teeth. Notice that the carousel starts first, and then notice the blanking perpendicular bars. Those are the doors. Once they are all open, then each belt starts in sequence. Now, so here's another quiz question. Why don't all the conveyors start at the same time? Nobody has an answer? These conveyor motors are from 1 to 5 horsepower. They're all powered from the same electrical panel. So what happens to you if you try to start 35 conveyors at one time is you may pop a circuit breaker in the electrical panel because of the inrush to all of the motors. So you have to think about startup in a little bit different scenario than you do. This is an actual ticket counter in Terminal 1 in Las Vegas. It's actually a very small piece of the ticket counters. And notice that there's not many operators. I'm really sorry these are not more visible. They're very nice looking on my screen. These are automatic, these are where passengers can come in with their bags, enter their reservation number, and then it prints the bar tag. The passenger puts the bar tag onto their bag and takes it over the counter, and then they put it into the system. They also check your ID to make sure you are the person that owns the bag. This is another kiosk showing the same thing. You get your boarding passes there as well. This system here has been in operation about five months maybe. Here are some other photographs of conveyors, kiosks in various places. The bottom right is a claim unit. This is the claim area of Las Vegas Airport Terminal 1. And these, if you've been to Stanford Field, they've got the equivalent of about 4 of these carousels. There are 16 of these carousels in Terminal 1. It's a pretty busy place. Here's some more pictures of makeup units. And now we get to the part you're interested in, the software, which I'm not going to talk about very much, but Todd is here to answer any questions you might have. The challenge that we have as a company is that students do not get exposed to this type of software development. You got all programming C or C++ or something of that nature. This is a completely different programming environment. And everything runs on commercial computers, but the database management and all the other stuff that you do has to be designed by us. And again, it's custom and very specific to that particular airport. So these are some control rooms in various airports. And then these are close-ups of the human machine interface software. So this is what you see on the terminal. And then these are alarm screens here. Also, if you think about it, you have to know all the flight information. So this system has to interface into the flight information system. And you've got to get the bag to the right carousel for that particular flight. So that all has to be ingested into the software. You've got a variety of workstations in various locations. that can be used by all of the operators. So now, having shown you all this stuff, what do control engineers do? They basically design, program, they oversee the electricians, and implement the systems that do everything that I've been talking about. This is not the sort of job where you sit off in a little corner and you do programming. What happens is you work on your program, and now you're finished with your Las Vegas program phase four, then you get on the airplane and go out there and try to make it work. With the millwrights and electricians that put the thing together, you think they're smarter than anybody else, most times. So, and the other thing that has to happen, you have to support the acceptance test and get the customer to buy this off, and customers can be cranky sometimes, and you have to be able to then document the system after it's been designed and built, and train all of the operators. And these are not Rhodes Scholars, these are not UofL students. These are folks with leather tool belts. So everything. So that's the end of the formal presentation. What I'd like to do is turn this over to Todd and let you guys ask him any questions and as to how he does his design effort. And the other part of it is, you know, Todd can do literally everything that I showed you in these slides. The other thing to think about is that with everybody hears about, you know, companies like Amazon and that they don't have retail stores anymore. Well, guess what they do have? They have distribution centers that are loaded to the rafters with these conveyor systems that move the goods that are being purchased from the manufacturer's truck that rolls up to the distribution center into individual packages that come out to you that then go into FedEx or UPS to get to your destination in 2 days or less, unless you want to pay extra. So there's a lot of this going on, especially in Louisville. So I'll turn it over to Todd at this point.
So, I mean, Andy gave you a pretty good overview of what we do, but just to let you know what I do. So I'm the design engineering manager at Control Touch, and I am in charge. I've got a few team members under me that help. We do the electrical design for all these systems. So we would take the customers and the consultant specifications, basically what they want the system to do, and we would turn that into an electrical design. We would pick out the components and design the panels that actually control all the motors. The very first thing we do, though, is we have to do a power calculation to know how much power we would actually need to run the system. So, like Andy said, we don't do the mechanical design. We don't do the motor layouts and the conveyor layouts themselves, but we do partner with mechanical fabricators. So we would get that information. We would get the number of motors, the horsepowers, the size, and everything else. And we would run the calculations through the NEC calculations, through the NFPA, UL, everything.
They may not know what all those are.
Okay, it's basically the industry standards for the do's and don'ts of the right way to install electrical systems. You have to have built-in service factors for overhead capacity to deal with the inrush current, but still be able to size your panels, your wire, your feeders to handle what you're trying to do. So once we do that, then the customer or the organization can actually determine how much power they have to power up the system. After that, basically once we get the design complete, then we would order all the materials that we would spec out to build that. I mean, it's kind of like going to the grocery store, you know, to make a cake. I need all these items. Well, to build a control panel, I still need all these items that we pick out. So we purchase all those, and then we have a couple places here in town that would actually fabricate that panel.
Comment on how many dollars worth of material we're talking about.
Well, for the Las Vegas airport, just for one of the systems, we spent close to $1 million just in hardware alone.
And it would fit in one semi-trailer truck.
Yeah. We loaded everything in the back of the truck and direct shipped it out there, and that's kind of our parts warehouse out in the field. So it's a lot of equipment. It's a lot of parts and pieces. I can't remember the exact numbers, but we're talking in the neighborhood of 30, 40,000 pieces for the Las Vegas job alone. So once we get through the electrical design, then a fabricator would actually be able to build the control panels per the electric prints, but also the field installers would know how and where to wire everything. We, like Andy said, we're not simply sitting at a desk writing software to control all this stuff. I mean, again, it's just like doing a lab here in school. You have to design a system, but then you have to test it. You have to make sure it works. Well, we can't test a 600 belt conveyor system in our office. We have to go where the conveyor system is, or we have to go where the MCP is, where it was fabricated, to actually test it. So we do have quality control checks all the way through the line to make sure everything works in accordance, but then we also have organizations come in after, whether it be the end customer or TSA, Battelle, test the system to make sure that it does what they asked it to do. So like Andy said, we do the software side of it. So we have the PLC is the programmable logic controller that actually controls the conveyors. We read inputs from human interface and we turn on outputs, turn on motors, turn on lights, diverts, actuators to move product from one line to another. We do the HMI software. A lot of times it is a third party application that we would do our graphics in, but we also do in-house custom development of a lot of our software. That's graphics, that's just simple human machine interface touch panels, but also database. We get into SQL Server, Oracle, to keep track and manage all of these bags that go through the system and tracking them through the system and the information of the bag, the passenger, where it's going, the status of the bag. All that information has to be kept, stored, and retrieved from somewhere. So there's a lot of parts and pieces that go in to build it all together, to get it working. So.
Talk about simulation and how we do our software testing.
So the simulation, basically we have a custom in-house piece of equipment that would simulate the conveyor system. So think of it as just the conveyor layout that we would have on a graphics, but we have software running in the background that would mimic the conveyor system itself, or mimic bags being put into the system. And then we would actually link that and interface that to the PLC program and basically run it through its process, make sure merges are working, make sure our bag tracking is working, we know where everything is at any given time. We can also simulate jams and make sure the correct conveyors stop when they're supposed to. Or we can simulate an emergency stop fault. An operator would hit an emergency stop button to stop the conveyor. We make sure that the correct conveyors shut down that are supposed to. So there's a lot of back and forth. It is as close to the real world as we can get in our office.
Could you talk about how many motors a conveyor, a typical PLC might control? I mean, I know you subdivide the system, but I've never figured out exactly how you make those decisions.
So Las Vegas, just to let you know, so one system is about 600 conveyors, and it has five PLC pair that run the system. I guess the generic answer is about 100 to 150. It all depends on what's going on though. I mean, there's a lot of factors that go into that as far as how many of them are tracked, you know, are they just transport conveyor, a lot of different algorithms we run through. A lot of it is gut feel because we've been doing it so long to run the system. But getting back, what I mean by PLC pair is we started and we've been doing it for a while, but Vegas is a big proponent of it. They actually have redundancy in almost every aspect of the system, even down to the controller. So the way we have it is we have one primary PLC that is running everything in the system at any given time. If anything were to happen to that controller or his communication modules to the outside world or any of the data into it for it to process, it will automatically switch over through our configuration. It'll switch over to the second redundant PLC and take over. I mean, that's the same for our servers. That's the same for our graphics applications. They have redundant bag tag readers throughout the system. If one bag tag, if something were to fail on it, it would automatically switch over to secondary. So that just shows the importance that Vegas is putting on their baggage system and basically how important it is to keep that alive and keep that running to process the bags through the system such that they can get on the plane to keep everything moving and the customers happy.
So, So how many of you want to be control engineers? I don't think we did a very good job.
Could you explain a little bit how you define control engineer based on, you know, because we have here electrical engineers, we have computer engineers. Where is the control? And we have industrial engineers.
Well, I'm electrical by trade, but we definitely do CCS as well, high control touch. Like Andy said, I get into a little bit of everything. So the first 6 years or so at Control Touch, I was a software programmer. I did the PLCs, I did the upper level, I did the HMI. I went out to the field to make sure it was all starting up. You get your hands dirty, you get into it. Again, you can't just test it in the office. You gotta go out to the field and actually make sure that it works, make sure the electricians followed the drawings, make sure the mechanical guys installed the system the way you thought it was gonna be installed. So a controls guy is a little bit of everything. I mean, you're gonna get into electrical. You're gonna, whether it be the design up front or whether it be troubleshooting components in the field, you're gonna get into electrical side. Programming, again, we can go all the way down to the PLC level, HMI, database, everywhere in between. We get into testing, documentation. So we get into a little bit of everything.
In our world, everything he just described is a control engineer. It's a multidisciplinary endeavor. Mm-hmm. It's not control theory in feedback loops and the types of things that we'll be talking about.
What is the difference between good interdisciplinary team, which contains software engineer, electrical engineer, industrial engineer, and some specific guys who knows everything? Well, is it really these problems are real interdisciplinary problems which has to experts in every domain, not only the people who knows everything a little?
We don't have the luxury as a small company of allowing people to sit and be a specialized database programmer, for example. Mm-hmm. Although, as a matter of fact, I don't believe any of our competitors that I know of do things that way either. So when we use the term control engineer in industry, it means a person who can do everything in those slides that I just talked to you about. And that is the difficulty that we have with hiring, because if you think about it from a hiring and selection point of view, we come to the career fair here at the University of Louisville, and we may be looking for electrical engineers or computer engineers and or computer science majors, but if the student has a very channelized vision of what they will and will not do and what want to do for their career, we don't need that kind of person. We need people who are curious, who can do a lot of different things. And so this is the dichotomy we have as an industry and as an academic organization. How do you prepare, in I don't know, 10 years ago, most companies, maybe 15 years ago, it's been longer than that, most companies would, especially larger companies like Boeing and the defense and space companies, would understand that they're going to have to invest a couple of years in a young engineer coming out of school to get them to the point where they can be productive. But for us, our engineers come to work and we say, can you be on a plane Monday to go to Las Vegas for 2 weeks? Because we're bringing the system up. And we don't have the luxury of spending 2 years grooming a student to be what we need. That's why we are such big proponents of the co-op program here at UofL. It's very unusual to have a university and an engineering program where you can actually get students into the trade, if you will, of what we do before they graduate. So we recruit, or try to recruit, a lot of our students that we hire as co-ops, because at that point they know pretty much everything that I just showed you. They may not be experts, but they've got a pretty good understanding of how the system works and they can do troubleshooting.
Well, we have time for at least one, maybe one and a half questions.
Here's one.
I have the sign up sheet. If you just sign your name, we appreciate it. We try to keep track of how many people are here. We probably will not, if you didn't sign, please do sign. And the pen there is mine, don't take it.
Okay. So, first of all, I need to understand what's the difference between the PMC and the PAC, programmable control from inventors. I heard about that one time.
Programmable what?
PAC, programmable automatic control.
The PLC and the PAC, programmable automation controller, usually deals with axes of motion.
Yes.
So you would get into servos and robotics. A lot of the controllers we use are actually classified as PACs, but they're classified as PACs, but we don't use the motion side of it. We use the base PLC side of it. We don't get into a whole lot of robotics, but the same controller we use does handle that application.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You are building a distributed control system,
uh-huh.
and you are connected many PLCs to this control system.
Mm-hmm.
Does it matter if you are connecting like different platforms like Siemens, Toshiba?
No, we've actually done that. There are quite a few different platforms, and I mean even within the same manufacturer, there are different families and different classes of PLCs as far as the memory and horsepower that they provide. Interface options and everything else. A lot of components across the industry are able to talk to each other because of industrial standards. I mean, Ethernet is a big one, obviously. I mean, but you've got Ethernet, Profinet, DeviceNet, ControlNet. I mean, there's all kinds of communication protocols that all these different platforms play together, play nice with. So yeah, you can definitely connect different platforms together.
I think we'll allow one more question.
Last one.
Okay. Quick.
Which one is preferable in programming PLC, like the sequential, the ladder, the function, the diagram?
A lot of the PLCs are ladder logic. It's really just rungs of logic. You got inputs, you got outputs. All of them support different types. I mean, structured text is kind of a C-based. That's another preferred, but a lot of it's ladder logic.
Okay. One more, just if there is a quick one. No? Okay. Well, thank you so much. And we'll see you next week. We have a speaker lined up. You'll get the announcement soon. Okay? The speaker is one of our doctoral students next week. So she will share with you her research. But I don't have the exact title. Thank you so much.
So do you collect email addresses? Is that how you get them, the
Smith? The students, that's a good thing. We...